evening again, my good people. And again, Merry Christmas. During the holidays, families often watch classic movies like The Miracle on 34th Street. And I always find Christmas shopping challenging. Years ago, I went into Macy's on 34th Street in Manhattan and asked the saleswoman, I'd like to buy a gift for one of my brothers. What do you recommend? And she took a flashy time off the shelf and put it on the counter, and I said, how much? The reply, $100. I hesitated. I would like to see something cheaper. She showed me another gift. I said, how much? That's only $75. I finally said, you don't seem to understand. I want to see something cheap. And she handed me a mirror. That's the last time I ever asked for something cheap. Seriously, every year we relive the wonderful Christmas story, a baby in a trough, a mother holding her child in her arms as her husband Joseph stays near, angels singing and shepherds running over the hill to tell the child how much they love him. The gospel, according to John, sums up this love story in a single line. The Word was made flesh. That single line takes us back to the beginning of the human family in the book of Genesis. There, man and woman walked with God. They had friendship with God and with one another. But somehow or other, man and woman lost that friendship. They fell from grace. And Genesis describes very simply, yet very powerfully, that fall. They hid from God, and one blamed the other. But God did not leave us to ourselves. Remember the words of the prophet Isaiah. Can a mother forget her child? And even if she should, I will never forget you. And so continued the story of salvation. And in the midst of Israel's triumphs and tragedies, fortunes and misfortunes, fidelities and infidelities to the God's covenant, God never reneged on his promise. And so the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. The Word of God for the Christmas liturgies is like a prism through which is refracted the multiple facets of this great mystery of the incarnation. God become one of us. Isaiah proclaims glad darkness. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Paul writes that the grace of God appeared in Jesus Christ, who made us heirs to the promise of eternal life. In the gospel, according to Luke, the Virgin Mary gave birth to her son. She wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger. And the gospel, according to John, sums up the meaning of Christmas. The Word became flesh, and that is God's greatest gift to us. Some of us may be stressed out from holiday activities and wondering if the so-called perfect gift is really what someone else needs or wants. Marion Wright Edelman, a children's advocate and author, got it right when she wrote that the best presents she received as a child were not wrapped in pretty boxes or found under the Christmas tree. From her father, she received the gift of a love for reading. For him, books to improve the mind were more important than buying toys. From her mother, young Marion received the gift of a passion for children's rights. Her mother asked her to share her room with a child whose parents weren't able to care for the child. This was one of nearly a dozen foster brothers and sisters. And from a neighbor, young Marion received the gift of courage not to be afraid when something important or good just had to be done. Marion Edelman wrote in her autobiography, "I carry with me and treasure the lessons in life my parents and caring neighbors gave me throughout my childhood. And may these memories give me the strength to give a child a true gift. Time spent with them, time spent sharing some of the great lives of mentors who have enriched, informed, and helped shape my life. Yes, some gifts really can transform the lives of people. Gifts of teaching and listening and supporting, of sharing time and experiences, gifts of compassion and forgiveness and affirmation and support. And this kind of gift giving begins in our own families and workplaces and communities. Enduring gifts that we can always give to one another. Now back to Christmas. The Word became flesh. That changed our destiny forever. Christmas means not simply God in Bethlehem centuries ago, but God within us. We carry within ourselves Emmanuel, God with us. How? By virtue of the life-giving waters of baptism. We gather this evening to proclaim the awesome Word of God, to celebrate the presence of the living Christ, body and blood, soul and divinity in this liturgy. For we are by grace what Jesus Christ is by nature, sons and daughters of God, heirs to the kingdom of God. And that great truth of faith, God within us, ought to challenge us always to be good finders, looking for the good not only in ourselves, but in other people and in every situation in life. Look for the good in ourselves. Remember that magnificent hymn of the Virgin Mary, "My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior." Why? Because the Mighty One has done great things for me. Mary rejoiced in the gifts God gave her. And so too, we should rejoice in the gifts that God has given us. Look for the good in other people. Someone wrote that people in many ways are like wildflowers. And if you ever studied a wildflower, you will see the delicate veins, the fragile petals, the beautiful blossom. And if you turn that flower into the sunset or sunlight, you will discover its special symmetry. The wildflower has a beauty all its own, and so too do people. And finally, look for the good in all situations in life. When one door closes, often another door inevitably opens if we pay close attention. And who is the ultimate good finder? God so loved us that he became one of us. Yes, Jesus is the ultimate good finder. Jesus had a unique relationship with the God of ancient Israel. He was, in fact, one with God, a God-man, a healer, a teacher, a peacemaker. Think of all the people in the gospel that Jesus met, the blind, the leper, the lame, the sinner, the forgotten. And Jesus found goodness in all of them where many didn't. The promised Messiah has come. He is in our midst sacramentally and mystically, and he will come again in great glory and power at the end time. And pray this Christmas season that the Lord will help those who doubt to find faith, those who despair to find hope, those who are weak to find courage, those who are sick to find health, and those who are sad to find joy, and those who have died to find eternal life with God. And here is our Christmas challenge. What better season for wrongs to be righted and friends reunited, for new dreams to start? What better season for mending and healing, for saying and feeling what's in our hearts? What better season for love to keep glowing, for hope to start growing, for troubles to cease? What better season for sharing and giving, for once again living in joy and peace? May the Lord bless and keep each and every one of you.